Hello everyone, welcome to Lion Pride Sports. I'm Neil Fischer. Seasons are wrapping up around campus while others are just getting started. With just a few home games remaining on the schedule, we'll have Lindenwood Women's Hockey Head Coach Scott Spencer, who is in his fifth season. And after that, we'll have Lindenwood Men's Wrestling Head Coach Jimmy Rollins, who has led his team to a top national ranking. But first, Coach Spencer, how are you doing today?
Good, thanks for having me.
Coach, big news in women's hockey right now. Jada Burke and Sierra Bird have been named CHA Players of the Week. What has that meant to the program?
We had a real good weekend against the first place team in our conference, Robert Morris, this past weekend. So, it's been a little bit of a struggle at times to get the wins this year. So I think we're starting to get hot at the right time. And both Sierra's been dealing with a few injuries right now, and for her to get on the board this weekend was huge for her confidence, scoring two goals, and then Jada's been pretty consistent here over as a freshman this year. She just finds ways to get to the dirty areas, and she's a big body, so she's a kid who's willing to pay the price to get a few points and goals in there.
How does the confidence rally over to going on the road, going to Syracuse to play them?
You know what? Again, we preach to our kids that, again, it's a process through the whole year, and we want to be good in February and March when playoffs roll around, and it's a learning experience and stuff through the early parts of the year. And, you know, I think the way we won on Saturday against Robert Morris, beating them 6-1, we've created chances all year, and finally they started going in for us. So I think our confidence is pretty high right now. We put up eight or nine goals against Syracuse when they were here back in October. So having confidence that we can put the puck in the back of the net will be huge for our group this weekend heading out to Syracuse.
And that's what I wanted to talk about. How much does it mean to play teams twice, once at home and once on the road?
You know, most coaches have tendencies, so there's not a lot of change through most of the coaches, and again, there hasn't been a lot of turnover in the coaches in our conference over the last, well, since I've been here. So we all have our things and our styles. There's some subtle adjustments here and there, you know, but teams are obviously different from the first half to the second half. You know, it's just your young players now, they've got a few college games under their belt and their confidence is growing. So, you know, usually teams are better in February. If they're not, then the coaches are not doing something right from there. So, I think it'll be a good test for us. It might be shaping up that we might have Syracuse in the first round of the playoffs too. So it'll be a good weekend. Maybe not try and show too much and keep a few secrets in our back pocket for maybe playoffs.
Speaking of the playoffs, you mentioned it earlier, everyone makes it. So talk a little bit about how the playoff system works.
Okay, well, there's six teams in our conference, and to go to the national tournament, our conference has an automatic qualifier. So the first two seeds in the regular season, they get a first round bye, and then three plays six and four plays five, and then from there the winners, the lowest seed will play one, and the next lowest plays two, and then it's the semis and finals. So you got to win three games in three nights, which is tough. And this year the quarterfinals are on a Wednesday, and we play Friday, Saturday the week before, so it could end up being about five games in 8 days, which will be tough. But you know, to keep your season going, you got to find the energy somewhere.
Is it important to get these last four wins on the season against Syracuse and Penn State to really make your mark in the tournament?
I think more so for confidence reasons. I don't know how much, again, we will need a lot of help to kind of juggle a lot of movement, because the teams that are kind of chasing each other are all kind of playing each other. You know, like Robert Morris and Mercyhurst are the top two teams are playing each other this weekend. So everybody else. So we'll know more after this weekend as far as whether we can move up or down in the standings right now. But it's more just the confidence of knowing that we're playing well heading into the playoffs. That's my biggest concern more than anything.
So. You talked about the first half of the season is always different than the second half. Have you changed your style of coaching from the first half to the second half and learned things about your team?
Not really changing any style. You know, I try to remain pretty consistent with things as far as what we do and how we go about our business with our group. I think that's important to have that consistency. But obviously you have injuries, you have, you know, some kids aren't playing well, so you know juggling lines and different things, trying to find the right combination. You know, we've juggled a lot more with our line combinations than we have in the past, and that was kind of part of losing Taylor Girard at the start of the year for the year. And it's we've had a ton of injuries this year, which, you know, trying to find the right combination, and we're not scoring a lot of goals. So like I said, the past two weekends, you know, we put up 14 goals in the last four games with this current line combination. So, you know, it seems to be working right now, so I think we're going to stick with that. But that's more the biggest adjustments, is just juggling to see if you can just get a little bit more out of your group, right?
Is that a year-to-year thing that you find happening, that you have to juggle lines until you find the right ones, and when you find the right ones, then it really cements?
Yeah, you know, and again, we had probably one of the top lines in the conference last year with Paisley, Girard, and Burt. And obviously two were sophomores, one was a freshman. So that was promising for us as a group moving forward. And then this year, they've played, I think, five games where all three have been in the lineup at the same time. So it's just, you know, things that you can't control is the reasoning for that. And so you always have freshmen coming into your group. So, you know, you don't want to throw necessarily three freshmen on one line, especially if you got an older group where you don't have to do that to try and acclimate them into the group. But if you got a line that works well together, you know, you want to keep it. Don't fix it unless it's broken, right?
Yeah. So you talk about them being young, sophomore, and a freshman on the same line. Looking forward to the future, I don't want to go too far, but just in the next coming years, what is exciting you about Lindenwood women's hockey?
Well, again, just the growth out of our whole group. You know, this has been a four-year process of building the style, the type of character that we want to have in our program, that culture, so to speak. You know, it's cliche to say that, but, you know, getting the right kids in here and teaching them how to be pros. You know, the work ethic, the commitment level, the expectation level, you know, and that's been a process, and I'm happy with where we're at right now moving forward with our group, and I'm excited with the freshmen that we have coming in next year. We have a smaller class next year, but I think it can be a pretty impactful class that I'm excited to see, and you never know until they get here on campus. You know, every kid responds different. It's the first time away from home. You know, they're on their own, they're going to class, they're a little more responsibility. Mom and dad aren't making their breakfast for them anymore, and you know, lots of things can factor into how people adjust. So it's always a little bit of a flip of a coin, but from what we've seen of them as hockey players, we're excited with what I think they can possibly do to help out the program and keep it moving forward.
When I was a kid, me and the kids from the neighborhood used to always go to the Stick and Puck. It was like 15 minutes away at the local rink. But your team is from all around the world. How hard is that for that group to get closer over summers or even in the fall before the start of the season?
You know what, I think it's just hockey players are hockey players, right? So every team plays a different system or this or that. You know, I think it starts with the recruiting and the type of kid that we want to bring in. You know, they all have the pretty close to the same characteristics. They got to be able to skate. They got to have brains. You know, we can fix how hard you shoot the puck, and you know, the reps are just going to come with that stuff. But those are kind of two of the things that all of our players have. So when you've got the intelligence, it's pretty easy to adjust and be able to play with new players and so on. And everybody grew up. You know, there are a lot of them are from small towns in rural Canada and the United States, and they grew up going to the outdoor rinks, or just their rink was open all the time. The town I was from, the rink was open. You could just go in at any time, and, you know, a town of 1,000 people, right? So it is what it is, and, you know, so I think it's such a small knit community, the hockey world. So, you know, it's not a huge, huge adjustment, but it's, you know, it's finding more the chemistry with style of play, who can mesh with each other. But the personalities, hockey player will be the same as baseball. Baseball players are baseball players, right?
Yeah. So the senior class, there's only a couple of them. So what do you have to say about what they've meant to this program and what they've done to change the Lindenwood women's hockey program?
Well, like we were chatting with just before there, this is my first class, my first recruiting class, finally being seniors, and I've known, I knew two of them. I coached them before I came here back in Canada. No one of the other one with Shannon. When I took over this program, one of the first things I wanted to do with that first class was making sure I brought in quality character people that, again, would establish the culture, and I knew that kids that I could trust. And you know, for where they've maybe lacked on the score sheet at times, and their numbers aren't awful, but they haven't completely lit the lamp for us by any means. They have made up for everything with that, with their work ethic, their character. They have been absolutely phenomenal kids for the program, and they have established and carried through what I want the program to be to a T, and it's been absolutely awesome. So it'll be a fun day on Saturday, a couple weeks away against Penn State. I'm sure there'll be a few tears, and as it is normal, that's a normal thing with the girls' hockey. So we're looking forward to it. So it'll be a little bit bittersweet, but knowing that season isn't over yet, too, will be fun. It'll just be last home game.
So senior day coming up against Penn State. Are you an emotional coach?
No, they probably call me a robot. No, I try to keep all that stuff in.
I gotcha.
Yeah, so even keel, that's what I'd say.
All right, so, Coach, best of luck
to you. Perfect, I appreciate it.
That will do it for Lindenwood Women's Hockey Head Coach Scott Spencer, whose team will go at it one last time at home on March 1st and March 2nd against Penn State. Coming up, Lindenwood Men's Wrestling is one of the top teams in the nation. We'll talk to the man at the helm next on Lion Pride Sports.
Got a quarter?
What to expect when you're expecting a teenager.
Today we're talking about how to wake up your teen, and this works literally every time.
Good kisses. Good kisses. You heard how loud
I know,
that
I heard. I heard. It wasn't you. Yeah. It was the...
Is that bacon?
You don't have to know it all to be a perfect parent. Thousands of teens in foster care will love you just the same.
It appears these hot ashes are about to be dumped, which could possibly start a wildfire.
There.
How will Smokey deal with such a hot situation? The garden hose defense. Next, a thorough stir. Then, another spray. And finally, feeling if the ashes are cool.
Oh, yeah.
Ah, yes, the selfie. A ritual practiced so frequently with this tribe, but not so much by Smokey Bear.
Only you can prevent wildfires.
Todd's a great guy. I mean, look at him. What a sweetheart. Attaboy. Wait, Todd, what are you doing? How totally selfish and un-Todd-like of you. Come on, Todd. Come on, man.
Welcome back to Lion Pride Sports. I'm Neil Fischer. Lindenwood men's wrestling has improved a lot over the years, and most of it has to do with the man in charge, head coach Jimmy Rollins. So, head coach, how did you get to this point?
Oh, you know, it's a very historic program. You know, from the NAIA days, there's a lot of it. NAIA championships, individuals. You know, at this point, we've been just transitioning a little bit. Once we went NCAA, it was looking for guys that are the right fit for the staff, the direction the university wants to go. And it takes time. You know, it's not something that happens overnight. And with individuals in our sport leading to team success, it's very important to find those guys that are going to be the right fit.
How have you found those guys with the high character and quality to make the team really come together as one?
You know, you start with a core group, I think, and what we did was we recruited a core group of guys that we saw a lot into, you know, as far as character and different things like that, and obviously ability. And then it was looking at some transfers. This year we were fortunate enough to get a couple Division I transfers that were highly touted recruits coming out of high school that we originally recruited, who saw Lindenwood as a better option than where they were presently. Those guys coming in and it being easily accessible from the camaraderie standpoint and everything else in our group makes a big difference in how we perform.
Is there a lot of difference between the Division I level wrestling and the Division II level?
You know, you're going to see individuals. One of our guys was a Division I national qualifier, transferred from Appalachian State. The other one was a top four recruit in the country coming out of high school. You know, it's not so much of a difference in necessarily the caliber all the time, sometimes the depth. You know, you got a lot more opportunities to qualify in Division I than you do Division II. And mainly the Division I top tier are the top tier. We definitely have a lot of guys that compete at that level, are open, for example, bringing in 42 schools, and I believe there was 17 of them Division I level competing at our open. You know, so we're constantly competing against Illinois, Iowa's, Oklahoma State's, all the top guys in the country. It's a great thing about our sport is we kind of get to go at it with, doesn't matter. One guy goes out, another guy goes out. Doesn't matter where you're from, what you're doing, you get to compete. So,
does that help you guys learn about your team and what kind of style of wrestling that you need to accomplish?
Yeah, you know, it's from us, we really preach that we don't try to preach a certain style. Each individual has their own aspect. What we try to do is harness their skills, improve them, and make them better, more well-rounded individuals than trying to tweak them and make them us. Each individual has their own style, and we just try to let them go with that, and each coach is a little bit different. I'm fortunate on our staff to have two NCAA champions as my assistant coaches, and they're in their mid-20s, so they get to work out every day with the guys. I'm not doing that as much as I used to. But, you know, all of our coaches have national championships under their belt. You know, I was on a couple different national championship teams, so understanding that and trying to recreate that is what we try to do.
What kind of preparation led to getting to where you guys are at this season? You're having a tremendous year, but what kind of workout criteria went into this season to make it what it is?
Oh, there's a lot of that. You know, we do a lot of things. It's distance runs and things like that. And our preseason are more designed not just from a cardio aspect, but from a mental training aspect. You know, to never leave Highland parking lot and you run 7.4 miles in a shuttle run is what we do. You know, after 2 miles of never leaving the same spot, it starts to wear on you. So we build that mental training and that stability. We always talk about taking our opponents to deep water. You know, it's you want to take them deep and pretty much drown them in a way. You know, that's not a good way to put it, I guess. But, you know, you really do. It's a sport where you're trying to physically and mentally break an opponent to show dominance. And, you know, there's not really another sport like that.
Do you think mental strength has a huge part in going such a long season?
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, we've worked with our athletic department this year, working with the Habitudes, with some different things, talking about, you know, iceberg methods and things like that. Today, tomorrow, we'll go over visualization training, you know, seeing yourself atop the podium. You see success, you believe success, you become success. And, you know, that's a big thing that we just try to preach is seeing yourself obtain the goals that you set. When there's that doubt in your mind, you train harder to leave no doubt. And, you know, I think it's a lot like anything else. It's just you're one-on-one out there and team implications and everything else. So we have to have all 10 guys and not to mention their training partners. You know, what gets lost a lot is all these guys that aren't representing the program in these varsity meets or such, but the guys that are training with them every day to get them to this point, they're a huge part of the success of all these guys.
Yeah, there's four seniors on the team right now. What have they meant to the program in this year?
It's been great. You know, Jared McKinley, he's really evolved as an athlete. Kyle Jolas kind of came out for us from the start and was a go-to guy for us. We pulled his red shirt as a true freshman, and then we redshirted him last year. So a little bit of a unique way to do it, but this was the thing. He wanted to be a part of this team. And it's the buy-in from all these guys. It's understanding that life's going to be horrible on certain days. You know, coach is going to kick my butt. This guy might beat me up. It's going through all those trials and tribulations. They get done high school and are state champions or high school All-Americans and then come to college and they're right back at the bottom of the barrel. It's earning that keep and understanding that you have to earn that keep. And our seniors, especially with this group, you know, gentleman George Carrero out of California, you know, came here, not a whole lot of experience. you know, has been a part-time starter for us, just working his tail off to get there. And, you know, he's like the Rudy Rudiger of our program, I always say. He's just a great young man, and that's what we have. We have a lot of these guys, Derek Hiles, you know, stuff like that, that are going on to something bigger and better after Lindenwood, whether it's medical school or anything like that, but have been invaluable to our program with just the type of young men that they are and the way that they help everybody.
So what do they mean to the team as on the floor during meets?
Oh, we got a rowdy group of guys, for sure. In the bleachers, it's there's no official that goes unharmed at any of our meets. You know, they do it with probably testing the line every once in a while on what should be said and shouldn't, but officials are used to that. They always commend us on our crowd and how our guys act. It's a big part. You know, the guys that are in there doing the right things, pushing you the right way when you're having a bad day, and then standing there cheering you on the sidelines, you can't ask for anything more.
So if somebody's never been to a wrestling meet before and this next Super Regional is at Highland Arena at Lindenwood, what would they expect to see?
The best wrestling in Division II. You know, we have 8 top 25 teams in the country, more than any other region in the nation. You have 2 number one ranked guys in the country represented in this tournament, one of them being our guys. You know, we have 6 individuals. I believe there's 26 ranked wrestlers in the top 12 in the nation. It's the best there is. It really is. If you're in Highland Arena on Saturday, you're going to see the best wrestling Division II has to offer.
So you guys do the meditation and see mm-hmm. yourself at the top of the podium every week. Do you see that at the end of the season?
Oh, you know, I'm not one that likes to try to predict or anything else. I believe in my guys. I believe that they believe in themselves. Each individual holds their own fate. You know, it's not like I can make a pitching change or do something to get something done. These 10 individuals have to represent us to the highest caliber. And it's in their hands. You know, we've done what we can as a coaching staff. They've done all the training needed. It's just going out and performing now.
So how much coaching do you have to do when it really gets into it? Do you have to scout the other teams and see their maneuvers and what they like to do and what they don't like
to
do?
Sure. There's definitely style matchups with individuals. Certain programs may do something, so you're looking for that. You're watching film on individuals, trying to key on where you're going to be able to make adaptations or scores. A lot of kids don't want to hear a whole lot about it. You know, it gets them into one individual. So as coaches, we're keying on those points and making sure that we're yelling that out during matches. Hey, watch for this on top, you know, direction moving towards his left leg, get him circling. A lot of different things. You know, as coaches, we wrestle every match pretty much with a guy. We might not physically be doing it, but in a corner, we're jumping around screaming like crazy. It's a very aggressive thing.
How do practices go? I know football teams have scout teams mm-hmm. for the underclassmen or the people who are not playing. Do wrestlers have a scout team almost?
Not necessarily. I mean, the coaches are working out every day. Unlike other sports, you know, we're getting bruised and bloodied every day as well. Sometimes our job's to go in there and try to, you know, beat up on a guy. Other days we're working on things. It's the survival of the fittest almost on a daily basis.
So do the coaches have control over the players when it comes down to the wrestling and getting on the mats?
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. I mean, I was always a guy that worked out every day with the guys. I'm now 36, so that tends to take a little toll on us. But, you know, our Dallas Smith, my assistant coach, and our other assistant, Terrell Wilborn, who was an NCAA champ for us in 2016 here at Lindenwood, those guys are training all the time with them, and not to mention all the other guys that are in there just fighting it out.
Do the players look up to those assistant coaches for information all the time and life changes and stuff?
It's definitely something with cutting weight and things like that. There's a lot of heart-to-heart conversations. You can find out a lot about yourself when you cut out all the water you're drinking and all the food and try to lose a substantial amount of weight. So there is a lot of that. You know, there's a lot of those conversations. There's a lot of talk about preparation, on how to not overlook opponents, how you view an NCAA championship or a regional event or each match individually. A lot of that is a makeup throughout the year. Like you said, we have 4 or 5 seniors on our team. This group's actually a pretty young group of guys. So seeing that evolve as quickly as it has, it's a testament to our staff really doing a great job.
So with the postseason coming up, who on your team is going to be the biggest threat to make a run at the national championship?
Well, I think we have some really good guys. Right now we have 6 in the top 12 in the national ranking. Actually, I believe it's 6 in the top 10. in the national rankings. We do have a number one ranked guy in Carlos Jaquez. You know, there's a lot of guys, I think, that have potential. Right now, he's a front runner. He's undefeated on the season. You know, he's a kid that plays fifth in the state in high school. You know, not a highly sought-after recruit. Watched him at the state tournament. We're signing his older brother out of junior college, and this young man just stood out by the pace that he kept, and a little scrawny guy. And all of a sudden now, he's really put all the effort in. And that's a testament to alumni we have coming back to help train with our guys. We have All-American Marco Tamayo from a few years ago, comes back to train with our lightweights, as well as other guys that are always in the room. You know, it makes a big difference.
Quick question for you and quick answer as we're wrapping things up. You guys made a huge signing this year with 10-year-old Chris Beeney. Yeah. What has he meant to the program?
Chris has been great. You know, we just had him playing laser tag and demolition ball with the guys on Sunday. You know, we always talk about the struggles he's going through is something that hopefully none of us have to go through. But it's a testament that, you know, life is bigger than sport. And I think that he's given us a point of reflection week in and week out to serve somebody going through something that we're not going through, but we're happy to be along on the journey for him. But he's a great kid.
Awesome, awesome Coach. Kid. Thanks for joining us. Thank you to Coach Rollins and Coach Spencer for joining me. Good luck the rest of the way. Catch the women's hockey team at home against Penn State March 1st and 2nd, while the men's wrestling team competes at Highland Arena in Super Regionals on February 23rd. I'm Neil Fischer. Thanks for watching Lion Pride Sports.